But Hubert Humphrey
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
Mr. George Gallup has passed along the word that the American public is in a mood to consider alternatives to the present leadership. And seldom in American political history has there been such a stampede of patriots willing to come to the aid of their country. In the weeks and months ahead, we will on this program attempt portraits of all the Republican candidates for president, all of whom, as it happens, have appeared previously on Firing Line in other capacities than presidential candidates. Robert Dole spent an hour shortly after his defeat as vice presidential candidate analyzing the plight of the Republican Party and predicting that it remained the only viable political opposition. He was correct. The next president of the United States will not be a member of a third party. Senator Dole was born in Kansas, studied at the University of Kansas and at the University of Arizona before taking his degree in law at Washburn Municipal University in Topeka. He entered Congress in 1961 and subsequently the Senate. He served as chairman of the Republican National Committee during the difficult Watergate years, though he yielded the office to George Bush, also a presidential candidate, before Mr. Nixon's resignation. During the World War, he was decorated for heroism. It is suggested that some of the combat tactics he developed during the war became mutatis mutandis, a part of his repertoire as a politician. During the presidential campaign of 1976, he acquired a reputation for a polemical ruthlessness heavily laced with wit, as is well known, for instance, to professional comedians. Hard political jokes are supposed to be at the expense of Republicans, otherwise it's foul play. The examiner will be Mr. Jeff Greenfield, about whom more in due course. Canada Dole is a figure, however, out of Vatican II. He began his announcement by apologizing for his reference to democratic wars, though one doesn't know whether this constitutes a commitment, should he become president, to revise the history books. In any event, he has adopted a number of positions which mark him by the usual scale as a moderate. I should like to begin by asking Senator Dole whether, if nominated, he would prefer to do battle against Jimmy Carter or Edward Kennedy.
Well, my own view is it'll be Jimmy Carter. I think I don't have any preference, but it seems to me as I drive by the White House each day on the way to work that, you know, Carter's there. I don't see any vacancy signs. I think he likes it. He'll not move, in my view, unless he's defeated in primaries. So, and as far as a preference, I have none. I think Kennedy, of course, is a great celebrity. He'd probably be a tough candidate, but the incumbent president would be a tough candidate, too.
So if you were to organize your campaign strategy, you would not distinguish between the two. You would be saying pretty much the same thing.
Well, I think as we pursue the nomination, in my view, that it must be, what can Bob Dole do to provide leadership, and why should I vote for Bob Dole rather than one of the other 7 or 8 Republican candidates? How can I put an organization together in Iowa and New Hampshire and Florida? But I think essentially it's pretty much the same. We can take their health care plans, the Carter plan or the Kennedy plan. Combined, I doubt they have 25 votes. So, there's not much difference in philosophy. I think Carter's under some constraint because of the budget. He is the president. Senator Kennedy, of course, has that freedom that we senators have of not having to worry about those things.
Well, you see, there's not much difference between Carter's and Kennedy's proposals on health. What is the difference between your proposals on health and Carter's, since both of you seek to protect people from catastrophic illnesses?
Right. That one basic provision is pretty much the same in the Carter bill, the Kennedy bill, the 3D, the Dole, Domenici, Danforth proposal, and in the proposal of Senator Long, who does have some influence in the Congress and in the Finance Committee. But beyond that, we have Kennedy wanting this immediate comprehensive program at a cost of about $63 billion, and Carter, who wants to sort of sneak up on it, an incremental approach, which would cost initially about $24 billion. Our proposal would be limited to catastrophic, some expansion of Medicare at a cost, I might say, to the private sector of about $7 billion and to the public sector of about $2 billion for a total cost of about $9 billion. But the basic difference is that ours looks at the private sector, looks to the private sector, while in effect the Kennedy and Carter plans look elsewhere.
Well, mightn't a critic of your plan say about it what you say about Carter's plan, that it is an incremental advance on a role for the public sector in health insurance?
I think that's one criticism. In other words, just ours is a foot in the door. But it seems to those of us who support this approach that there is that need to be filled, and it hasn't been met in the past, but we can fill that need and take care of between the needs of 7 to 11 million Americans without this vast, comprehensive system that Kennedy advocates year after year, that would in effect federalize medicine, disturb the doctor-patient relationship, change the entire system, and I believe very honestly, ration health care, because he sets a budget and that's it. That's how much you can spend, and I don't believe we can ration health care in America.
Well, I don't think there's anything in Kennedy's proposal that would forbid people from spending more money for additional health care, is there?
Oh, if they had the money. No, that's no problem if you have the money.
Yeah.
But in Kennedy's proposal, whether you're a millionaire or below the poverty line, you would still be entitled to certain benefits.
Mm-hmm. But hasn't it proved historically correct that the difference between the Republican position on something and the Democratic position on something is about 8 years?
And what
is there about the Dole approach that would guard against that continued increase in the public sector, which seems to be almost ineluctable?
Well, I think very basically we try to set a limit. In other words, if you pay above $5,000 for medical costs, then according to our bill, you would be covered by the so-called catastrophic coverage. But again, we mandate the employer to provide that coverage. We don't ask the public to provide that coverage, and Kennedy does in the catastrophic area himself. But we don't reach out and start the cradle-to-the-grave approach that Kennedy says very clearly he will do in his program. Carter, and I've discussed this with Secretary Califano in a public, not debate, but a public discussion, there's not much difference in the thrust of the Kennedy and Carter proposals. And the thing that it's almost amusing, you would think if you watched the networks or read the newspapers that one of the other, either the Kennedy bill or the Carter bill, was on the verge of passing the Congress. And I would say very honestly, I don't believe that Kennedy could muster 25 votes, and I doubt that Carter could muster 25 votes.
In the Senate?
In the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, probably get more than 25 in the House. Mm-hmm. But my point is, if there's any legislation passed, as I believe there will be in the Senate, it'll be patterned pretty much after the Republican proposal, supported by the efforts of, again, Senator Russell Long, who has some influence in the Senate.
Well, would it be fair to say that the difference between you and Carter at this point is $2,500? He's proposing to protect beyond $2,500. You're proposing to protect beyond $5,000. Is that oversimplistic?
I think that's over. That's true insofar as the catastrophic coverage is concerned, but they go beyond the catastrophic coverage. They're going to start bringing in infants from 0 to 1 year, and then to 2 years, and then to 3 years, and then to 4 years, and pretty soon it'll be 18 years of age, and we'll have a total comprehensive program. We do expand certain Medicare benefits. We try to provide some relief to those in the Medicare. We do not combine Medicaid and Medicare, as Carter suggests. We think it ought to be kept separate. But there are some, I guess we can discuss the Carter proposal, even though it hasn't yet been made. They've mm-hmm. talked about it, but we haven't seen the fine print.
Yeah. So you're in favor of the survival of individual state systems.
Very much.
So as to continue the federal process of being able to view how they operate.
We not only should we have the survival of the state systems, we ought to make certain that there's some incentive for the states to look at error rates and some of the abuses in Medicaid, and to help us reduce the cost. In fact, we're looking at that very area right now in the Congress and in the Senate Finance Committee, how we're going to reduce hospital costs, how we're going to bring about some control, but it's very difficult to do because when you're sick, you know, you want the best possible care, you want it right now, and you don't want to travel too far to receive it.
Moving on, here you are in a contest against fellow Republicans for the favor of the delegates. Now, looking ahead, one can see that certain issues are going to crystallize, because after all, most of you are agreed on your differences with Carter, but there are some differences among yourselves. Will Howard Baker's backing of the Panama Canal treaties play a role in the primaries?
I think it could play a role.
Do you intend to bring it up?
I have a different view than you have on the Panama Canal, and I don't quarrel with your view, and
you probably
won't quarrel with mine. But it could be. I think, you know, in my view, the Republican convention will be made up primarily of conservative Republicans. They'll probably have a little list in their pocket. They'll have Bob Dole supported McGovern on food stamps. Howard Baker voted for the Panama Canal. They'll have a little, and maybe John Conley was for price controls. And I assume they'll make book on all of us, so I would guess it might
George be. George Bush was for Nixon.
George Bush was for Nixon. And, you know, at least. But.
What I'm asking is, do you propose to bring the subject up in the primaries? For instance, if you find yourself in mortal. In mortal combat with Baker in a particular state. Are you going to say you're looking at a man who proposed giving away the Panama Canal treaties to a...
Probably I would approach it in a little different way. I would only hint that I did not vote for the Panama Canal.
How do you do a dull hint? <That's>,
I remember so well in 76 when Fritz Mondale, who's a friend of mine, the vice president, excuse me for referring to him as Fritz, but used to make almost in every stop that I will not mention Watergate. I will not mention the pardon, and then he would move on to something else.
Yeah, that's called paralepsis.
Paralepsis, whatever. As in paralysis.
I came to bury Caesar, not to praise him.
Right. But I wouldn't want to put Baker at a total disadvantage.
He has enough disadvantages.
Not even saying that. I mean, I think he'll rise to the occasion. But
let me distinguish then between Panama, which presumably is something that has happened, and something that hasn't happened, concerning which you have differences with some of your colleagues. You mentioned food stamps. It is obviously going to be said that the reason you're for food stamps is because you're from Kansas. and that that it is unconvincing for any senator to plead the cause of husbandry if he isn't willing to exercise a little discipline in that which is desired by his own constituents. To which you would answer what?
To which I would say very honestly, if you polled the American producer, he would probably vote 2-1 against food stamps, though I must say that they fail to realize that they do benefit from the food stamp program. We're talking about a program of almost $7 billion. But on the other hand, I think we must recognize that there are people in this country who wouldn't have an adequate diet unless we had some program. And before we had food stamps, we had commodity distribution. We gave people cans of peanut butter and pounds of regular butter and flour. We converted to a food stamp system.
Why couldn't you say that about medical care?
That everybody has to have medical care? Mm-hmm. Well, I think in essence, we find about 80-90% of the people with some medical care, and I think there are probably some that we're going to have to take care of through Medicaid.
Well, you found 80-90% of the people with food, too.
Maybe not enough food.
Maybe not enough medical care.
Well, I guess you can make the argument, but mm-hmm. My point is that we've always had some effort, either through welfare payments or through commodity distribution. But there's been a recent report by the Field Foundation that indicates that the food stamp program has met its objective, that particularly senior citizens and now those living in rural areas are being attracted to the food stamp program. We're talking about the very poor. 82% of the people who participate in the food stamp program are very poor. Not many own an automobile. Some have 20% maybe own their own homes. So we're not talking about a program that is designed for someone to rip off the American taxpayer.
It's not designed to do that, but it is true, as most Republican spokesmen have alleged, that there are widespread abuses. And the food stamp program, which began as something less than $1 billion, has gone up 700%. And a lot of people know that as many as 25% or 30% of the people who attend expensive schools use food stamps.
Well, we've changed that. Less than 1% of the participants now are students or strikers. So we're talking about 1% of the total 19 million participants are in that category. Plus, I think we have to recognize that the poor people suffer from inflation, too. Their food prices go up, whether they pay for it, buy it with food stamps or with dollars. And I must say that the food stamps period of greatest growth was during the Richard Nixon presidency.
Well, yes, which is a criticism often made of Mr. Nixon, though, of course, it was a Democratic Congress.
He had the so-called war on hunger, but he had a lot of pressure from Democrats who believed that we should expand the program. It went from, I think, around 2 million in 69 up to 18.5 million by 76. And then it went down a little bit in Carter's first year because unemployment dropped a bit. Now it's back up to 19 million. It's a big program. 12% of the American people are in it.
But I know, and this is one of the criticisms of it. The Republican philosophy presumably has to survive these election campaigns, and the Republican philosophy is that as affluence increases, you should rely more and more on the private sector rather than on the public sector. For the record,
right.
I'm in favor of free food for everybody, right. Provided free food is defined as Ms. Logue in Washington does, giving those four commodities, which make up 99% of the dietary requirement. She puts the cost of that at $2 billion for anybody who would want to avail himself of it. That's my own position. But the food stamp program is viewed by a lot of tough economic analysts as a pro-farmer program rather than a pro-hunger program.
Well, I think it may be viewed, too, as it's probably the greatest step in welfare reform we've had in a long time. But we're concerned about the fraud, and we're concerned about the abuse, and I think it's fair to say that later on this summer and the fall, we're going to be having field hearings looking for fraud and abuse. And the one thing that's never mentioned when you talk about the cost of the food stamp program is the fact that we have tightened it up. We're getting complaints now from states like New Hampshire, which is important to a lot of people and will be later on, and Vermont and Kansas, that many people are being forced off the food stamp program because we did tighten up requirements for eligibility. We do have an assets test. we have tried to make certain, you know, that only the needy and not the greedy participate. There were examples a few years ago where airline pilots, in one case, qualified for food stamps. Where wealthy farmers could qualify for food stamps. If they had no liquid assets, they could qualify, and that it shouldn't be that way, and we've tried to change it. But having said that, you know, what are the alternatives? If somebody is hungry and without food, what do we do as a government? What do we do as a party? In my view...
What if somebody is sick without health?
Well, you have to take care of them, but you don't have to have a...
Does your program do it?
Well, if it's catastrophic, long-term, lingering illness, yes, because it can wipe you out, but we suggest that you ought to expend some of your own resources, too. And the very poor in any program will be taken care of.
And what is the comparable distinction in the matter of food?
Well, the matter of food, I think we have 12% who receive food stamps. The average payment is $30 a month. The average per meal cost is 33 cents. Now, where in America can you buy a meal for 33 cents?
Having eaten in the Army, I would say there.
Well, I think not even there. I remember the Army food, even in those days, well, it might have been worth 33 cents for the day, but I guess the point I make is that it's you know, I worry about our party sometimes, and I know that some of my conservative friends like to fuss at me about food stamps, but it seems to me that unless we're addressing problems, there's not much reason for us to be around, and this is a problem. And I believe it doesn't destroy our conservative philosophy to look at the needs of the American people, and that may be idealistic or...
Well, speaking of the destruction of conservative philosophy,
yes.
How about your vote on the D.C. Amendment? Can you explain to me what interest the rest of the country ought to have in giving D.C. two more senators?
Well, I guess we'll find out what interest the rest of the country has during the ratification process.
No,
so far, would indicate...
What interest ought they to have?
Well, I think they ought to recognize that we have 600,000-700,000 people in the District of Columbia with no voting representation. If they're a Republican and they were at our convention, all they got to do is read our platform. It's right there with no equivocation.
Why don't you give them to Maryland?
Jesse Helms voted for it.
Why don't you give them to Maryland?
Oh, that was tried. Maryland, you know, it's a, you know, like the old saying, I don't want the ball. You know, give the ball to Joe. I don't want the ball. They didn't want the honor, I guess, of having additional people attached to Maryland for that purpose. So we've now passed that. That, I might add, has brought me the sting of Mr. Loeb and the Manchester Union leader. But, you know, I've been stung before.
Maybe well, it brought you more than the sting of Mr. Loeb.
Well,
it brought you the sting of me.
Well, but I was distressed when you supported the Panama Canal, so, you know, we're even.
Oh yeah, but I'm not running for president.
Well, that's true.
The criticism of that bill, as made, for instance, by James Jackson Kilpatrick, is that its provenance would appear to be directly political. The notion that the people who live in D.C. are underrepresented is bizarre, to say the least. They have a huge working lobby in the House of Representatives and in the Senate. To give them two extra senators is to defy the notion that there is a federal district in which civil servants live for the benefit of the country at large, who receive certain other benefits in turn. But to give them representation as a state is precisely to do what was not intended by the people who dreamed up the country. What is it that you are after? What needs of those people are being denied under existing arrangements?
Well, I think that basically is the fact they have no voice in the Congress of the United States. They have Walter Fauntleroy on the House side and no one on the Senate side. Beyond that, it seems to me, and maybe this is not a defensive statement, but I recall in 76 I was asked a number of times, Bob Dole, do you support the Republican platform? I remember Governor Reagan making speeches all over the country about what a great platform we had. And right in the middle of that platform was voting rights for the District of Columbia, the Republican position. And here was Senator Dole, who ran with President Ford.
The voting rights is different from making it a state.
Well, I didn't suggest statehood. I mean, you don't have to have, you can have senators without, now without statehood. But it said very clearly, and I ran on that ticket. I think I was asked questions about that specific item in the campaign. I said I endorsed it. So I think my people can disagree with the vote, but it seems to me that it's the right thing to do. We submitted to the states. They're going to make a judgment. I've called Governor Quay, for example, in Minnesota to encourage him to, I think Minnesota did ratify the amendment. But right now, I think it stands 10 against and 6-4, as I recall.
So it's probably not going to go anywhere?
I don't know. I mean, it seems to me they have some problems.
Have you taken a position on ERA?
I was for ERA, but against the extension. It just seemed to me that you can't have it both ways, or shouldn't have it both ways. If you can't rescind, why should you have an extension to ratify? So I voted against the extension.
Now, Senator, you've spoken at some length on SALT II, laying down certain distinctions that you think need to be observed. Would you elaborate on those?
Right. Well, I think now having now that the document is available but not yet read by those of us in the Senate, the 79-page document, to start with, there are about, I would say, 12 to 15 Republicans, and I assume a like number of Democrats, who've been trying to go through an educational process. We've had a series of breakfast meetings where I've been one of the hosts, and we've had Secretary Kissinger, General Haig, Lord Chalfont, who advises Margaret Thatcher, Dr. Fritz Kramer, who has been in the Pentagon, he says forever, but I guess for 27 years, advising different administrations on global policy. Trying to fully understand what we're talking about, and secondly, to raise some questions, which we did in a letter to the President about 2.5 months ago, setting forth raising such questions, the backfire, whether or not it should be included, the limits on the cruise missile, sharing our technology, verification, and we're still waiting a reply. So what we've attempted to do, we've said we're uncommitted. Most of us voted for SALT I, voted for the ABM treaty. My point has been that we shouldn't choose up sides now and say, well, I can't vote for this because we have a Democrat in the White House and I'm a Republican and I'm running for president or whatever, and this may be a good issue.
Well, intending nothing personal right. about President Carter, it seems to me that at least if I were a senator, I would very often be influenced to vote for or against a measure depending on my confidence in the person who is going to administer the treaty. Now, I having very little confidence in our commander-in-chief, right. would be influenced by that fact alone, irrespective of the language of the treaty. I'll give you an example. In Israel, with former Prime Minister Rabin, discussing the treaty, he said on this program, to tell you the absolute truth, I'm not interested in what's in the treaty. It's going to work depending on whether or not Egypt and Israel have the will to make it work. Obviously, certain things are ruled out. I found that a very impressive statement. So it isn't really an act of demagogy to say I'm against this treaty because I have no confidence in the man who went in this direction on Panama, the man who went in this direction on Taiwan, the man who went in this direction on B1, this MX. Direction on Neutron, this direction on Rhodesia. Why would it be humiliating to you to say, I'm not going to back a treaty, which is, for so long as we have as a commander-in-chief, anybody as flaky as Mr. Carter?
They might roll out the hatchet man label again if I did that, but...
Well, I could teach you a nice way of saying it.
Right, well, that would help, it seems to me before, we ought to have the document. I don't say that we're going to debate more than the document, and I don't misunderstood. But it's you know, you can't shoot before the takeoff. And the takeoff, I guess, has now begun, and it'll start through the hearing process. It took us 7 months on the Panama Canal. I assume it'll take a great deal longer on SALT II. There is a question of the president's confidence in the president and his leadership. That certainly is one of the concerns that all of us have. But as far as maybe implementing the treaty, he may be gone in 1980. I mean, he may lose. He may not be a candidate. I don't know what will happen.
But well, you could pass it then.
It's been in the works for 7 years, so it didn't start with Carter. Though I must say that we're in a much different position now than we had been if Ford had been elected, because we probably would have gone ahead with the B-1 bomber. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't have held back on the MX for 2.5 years, and then suddenly said, well, we think we're going to do it, but we don't know about the basing system yet. So it's still a non-decision as far as Carter's concerned. They wouldn't have had the hanky-panky on the neutron bomb. We wouldn't have had troop withdrawals from South Korea, and probably wouldn't have let Iran go down the tube, and a few other things that I could think of, which would have probably given us a little more confidence in our leadership. No question about it. President Carter is perceived to be very weak in foreign policy. But I just don't believe I should make a judgment.
Based exclusively on his record.
Right, uh-huh. Because hopefully there'll be somebody else there to carry on after the 80 election.
I remember Ambassador William Bullitt in 1953 making a comment at a press conference when asked, it was earlier than that, when asked about Potsdam, that the trouble with Harry Truman was that he conducted himself when sitting opposite the table from Stalin as though he was dealing with an Etonian old boy instead of a Georgian bandit. Now, in as much as we are dealing with Georgian bandits, although sons of Georgian bandits, don't we have to look on this treaty as something on which we cannot rely to any extent that it presupposes good faith?
I think that's probably true, but as I look at it, well, I think it's certainly you'd understand everyone viewing this program, I think the bottom line must be, is it in our interest? And I don't suggest it's not in the Soviets' interest. Mm-hmm. They'll take care of that. They'll make certain of that. But the judgment we must make is that whether or not it's in our interest, and I also believe that those of us who want to jump around and politicize it at the outset, and that was done in the Panama Canal, I might add, which I did refuse to participate in that early effort to sort of politicize the Panama Canal debate, there may be amendments offered. You know, Senator Jackson has made very strong statements about the treaty on the eve of its signing by Brezhnev and Carter.
But do you think he's politicized it?
Well, I think he's given it sort of a bipartisan touch, and we'll see what develops with the Jackson forces and the so-called uncommitted forces. And if we make a determination that it's not in our interest, it's not going to bother me to vote against it.
Senator Baker on this program said that he would commit himself within 1 month of the publication of the treaty in order to avoid any charge that he was waiting to see what Gallup would say about it. Have you made any such commitment?
No, I'm not saying I'd want to wait and see what Baker said.
But
he's offered himself as the honest broker in this arrangement. But I'm not certain I want to put any timetable. Howard may have more information than I have. He may have access or be privy to more information. I have a number of advisors on the SALT II treaty, most of whom are hardliners. John Lehman, who's a former deputy arms control administrator, now a very bright young man, as you know. And I think some of us want to see what develops at the hearings and whether or not Carter's really going to move ahead with the MX. Is he going to make a decision, or is he buying time? Is he going to tell us the basing mode? Are we going to proceed? Weakness of the leadership is certainly going to be a factor in what's happened around the world.
Let me ask you this. If we go ahead with MX at $30 billion, how much net saving will we have effected by signing the treaty?
I'm not certain I know. You know, I don't That's
the idea of the treaty is to cause us to have to spend less to guarantee.
I understand that, right. Yeah. But I think it may be the price that Carter must pay for ratification. I'm not certain that this will do it. It seems to me that Carter, when he realized that he was really in trouble on SALT II, finally opted for a half a decision or a non-decision, which says, in effect, well, we're going to proceed with MX, but we don't know how. Ford made that decision 2.5 years ago, so we've already lost 2.5 years. That's the problem that one of the concerns that we have about, as you indicated, about SALT, but a lot of other things in the Congress is this sort of lack of clear direction, forward movement in foreign policy or domestic policy or any other policy in this administration.
Well, let me ask you whether there is an acknowledged leader in the opposition in the matter of military policy. Is Mr. Ford, say, or Mr. Nixon, yourself, Goldwater, is there a voice to which those who have not made a specialty of military affairs tend to turn with presumptive respect when trying to decide whether or not this is a treaty they ought to vote for?
I think many will frankly look to what may be uttered by Henry Kissinger, what President Ford may say, though I haven't any inside information on what President Ford might say. Senator Goldwater, I think, has a great deal of influence, but I would guess that when it comes down, when push comes to shove, it will depend on what some of us, I don't suggest there's any one leader, but what some of us do in the United States Senate, whether it's Senator Thurmond or Senator Baker or myself or Senator Lugar or
Stennis.
Senator Humphrey or Stennis, Jackson certainly. The point I've been attempting to make is that it shouldn't be a sort of we versus them, we the Republicans and them the Democrats.
Yeah.
Had that been the case in the Panama Canal, it would not have been ratified.
What kind of confidence do you and your colleagues have in the candor of the chiefs of staff when you hear their testimony? To what extent do you consider them more or less bound to present analyses that further the position of the commander-in-chief?
Well, I certainly hope that in the debate and in the testimony on SALT II that they will give their views and not Carter's views. But I noticed that one of our best negotiators, part of our team, General Rowney, is retiring rather than to face that problem.
Which means that he feels the pressure.
He feels he cannot support the treaty in good conscience. He's concerned about the backfire bomber. He's concerned about verification. I think he feels that the best way to least embarrass the president and maintain his own independence is step aside and perhaps be an influence, a proper influence, not to shoot the treaty down, but to educate some of us and to help some of us who are looking for answers on how we can have a good SALT II treaty, if we can have a good SALT II treaty.
What is your philosophical position on the duty of military technicians in such circumstances?
Well, it's a tough line.
That's why I asked.
Well, I figured that you had that in mind. And but in my view, on something like SALT II, they ought to give us their best military judgment. Let us make the decision.
Is there any way in which they can? I don't suppose there's any way in which they can do this with any kind of protection against retaliation by the executive arm, is there?
No, I think General Singlob learned that the hard way, and but we've had very.
But that was a little bit different because
right.
You didn't ask for his positions on South Korea.
No, he volunteered.
Although it did happen to Douglas MacArthur.
Right.
Joe Martin asked his position.
Right. Mm-hmm. But I think we've had a certain amount of independence expressed by Admiral Turner, the CIA, on verification, which brought about a quick statement from Secretary Brown that instead of maybe 3 or 4 years on verification, maybe we could do it in one.
Well, but yes, but you asked Turner a very concrete question. Was the CIA in a position to verify?
And right.
He couldn't very well say yes if the answer is no.
That's true.
Whereas you're asking for value judgment of the Joint Chiefs, aren't you?
That's true. But I don't know what the Joint Chiefs will finally say on SALT II. I hope they're not in lockstep with the administration, if in fact they have another view. I mean, it seems to me that's not insubordination. If they clearly perceive SALT II not to be in our interest, or if they perceive the verification to be a problem based on their knowledge, which is greater than the president's, greater than probably nearly everyone in the Senate, with the exception maybe of Senator Jackson, then we should be told that either in executive session or in public hearings.
But there's no such thing as an executive session which is proof against White House penetration, is there? Or is there? I really don't know.
Well, there could be, yes. I think they could vary, and I assume there will be some executive sessions.
You mean that the White House will not find out what was
said? A lot of this is classified, top secret. I assume they're all going to know, but I would hope that they would, well, I would hope that those who receive the information aren't going to peddle it, though.
Yeah, the president would know, wouldn't he?
The president would know. But, you know, members of Congress on occasion have been known to leave the president. Most recent example being the fellow who talked to the president about Senator Kennedy. Whether what would happen if Carter ran against Kennedy. I don't remember the precise conversation.
Or the precise language.
No, certainly. I think it was whip inflation or something like that.
The examiner today is Mr. Jeff Greenfield, well known to viewers of this program. Mr. Greenfield is a freelance writer. He has works of fiction coming up. He's a critic, a former aide to Mayor Lindsay and to Senator Robert Kennedy, Mr. Greenfield.
Thank you. Senator, I wonder if we could just broaden this beyond an issue-by-issue discussion into a more general notion of the presidency. One of the things I think that accounts for Jimmy Carter's persistent lack of popularity is the sense that he conveyed in 1976 that things would run differently, that he didn't come from the normal pool of presidential candidates, that he seemed to have a difference with the New Deal philosophy and somehow combined it with a hard-headed view of how government should work. And yet, when push came to shove, we had a list of marginally different proposals, so that both conservatives and people like myself who were distinctly not conservatives had a sense of disappointment. Now, at the risk of sounding like I'm giving you a softball, the question I would like to ask you is, in your own thinking about the presidency, say you've been in office 2 or 3 years, what would be different, either in the daily lives of the average American or in the way the government of the United States is working? And I don't mean that we would have more sunny days and that...
You'd have more food stamps.
Yeah.
No.
But I mean in the sense that would we notice, that's what I'm really asking, would we notice the difference?
Let's say in 76 I had been elected president and...
No, he's talking about 1980.
I mean, in 1980.
Oh, we have to go back.
Assuming you are elected and you get a chance to do what you want to do, would anyone notice? In the sense that I think if you ask people what's different now that Jimmy Carter's president, well, we have deregulated airfares, higher Social Security taxes, and we wait online at the gas pumps. But it's kind of hard to figure out what else. What do you hope would be different in concrete terms in our lives if you got the highest office around?
I think, first of all, you have to... maybe not agree that it was unfortunate the election in 76 turned out the way it did. Because if you go back and look at what happened with Ford's record on inflation, it went from over 12 down to less than 5 because he was tough enough, you know, to say no to the Congress and veto 53 pieces of legislation. It seems to me if we're looking at 1980 and beyond and say we have a tight race and I beat Jimmy Carter for president, between now and, of course, the election, I've got to develop what I... conceived to be my role as a leader. Now, we all have basic ideas. We haven't put those down into some glossy rhetoric that would have captured the imagination of the American people. But the basic problem with President Carter is this almost total lack of credibility, no follow-through. He hasn't consulted even Democrats, Democratic leaders in the Congress. And so I would just suggest that if I were the president, I think we would pursue not only decontrol, but an active policy of production and looking at alternative sources of energy, and yes, a windfall profits tax, if that's in the cards, but we would do it. We wouldn't talk about it for 2.5 years. I wouldn't send the Congress a tax bill to produce more energy, as Carter did a year ago.
But if I could just interject here, maybe I can be a little more specific. Would there be, in your own notion as to how a president ought to work, a certain kind of willingness to break fundamentally with the past? Mr. Buckley's inquiry to you on health, I think, was suggesting that the difference between your idea and Carter's idea was fundamentally a marginal difference. You're going to make us spend a little more money before you come in and save us, from $2,500 to $5,000. Essentially, it's a program in place. It's the office of HEW. I think what I'm more interested in knowing is, for instance, would there be an aggressive attempt to break the OPEC cartel? Would there be, in your notion, fewer people in absolute numbers working for the federal government by the time your first term was over? So, in other words, what do you envision? And I'm asking you for an ideal world, assuming you could do all this. What do you want to see happen that would indicate to us, hey, there really is someone different in the White House, and it's not just the accent?
Well, I think, first of all, you'd have an entirely different philosophy. You'd have different people around the next president of the United States. There would be efforts through increased production to break the grip, to get off our knees to OPEC countries. That's only going to be done when we start indicating to them that we can produce and that we can conserve. We're not going to be at the mercy of the OPEC countries. Insofar as inflation is concerned, we're going to have to be an example to labor and business and professional people. Carter has failed. I mean, he just doesn't have any leadership.
Senator, any president is going to want to set an example. Yeah. What I'm asking is, do you have, even in the broadest strokes, a sense of what that example translates into? Does it mean, for instance, a 20% cut in the line agency employment roles, or 10% cut, or what? Or no cut, but end waste?
I think you'd... I don't foresee any cut, but I think you maybe let it cut through attrition. You don't go out and just willy-nilly knock people out of their job, but you might not fill the vacancies. Carter's even tried some of this. But to say that we have a blueprint that would take you to the or down the middle where you're off one direction now, I don't believe so. But I don't think that's the basic fault with this administration. Much of Carter's problem lies with the Democrats in the Congress, not with the Republicans in the Congress. But he's not in a position to go out and go to the public because he's faced with Tip O'Neill on the one hand and Kennedy and Bob Byrd on the other hand. If I were the president, I could go to the American people on the energy crisis and on inflation and I think get a response from Congress where he's hemmed in.
A response to do what? I'm not
response to
difficult with Buckley, not with the guests, I don't, except with minor exceptions. What I mean is, even given the difficulties you have, any president would have in a congressional enactment stage, where I'm asking a very basic question. What do you want to do in concrete terms? I mean, you've announced a president. Presumably, you used to say about the vice presidency it was indoor work and no heavy lifting. The president has a rent.
The same about them. Yeah,
it's a rent-free house and helicopters, and I understand Camp David is lovely in the autumn. But beside those things which one might want as president, presumably you want to do things. You sat there and said, you know, if I were president, I could do X. You've spoken, I must say, in very general terms. You could get things through Congress. Right. What do you want to get through?
First of all, I want to look at the tax system. And I want to start a system of indexing where you don't pay taxes on inflation. You know, that's a concrete example. Mm-hmm. And it's a Republican idea. It's one that's been around, starting with Milton Friedman and Jim Buckley, by the way. I went to the breakfast with him years ago, and we sat there with eight of us. And now when Jim first offered, he had 20-some votes, now we're up to 37. Why should you pay taxes on inflation? That's a Republican idea. That's what I would pursue. I wouldn't leave it up to Congress every election year to index taxes. It would be done automatically. The American people could rely on it.
How would you control inflation at the other end?
Well, you're going to have to do that through a tough-minded president who's willing to veto legislation and rearrange our priorities. You know, we've got to do it. I mean, you've got to get up and say, I'm going to do it. And once you start doing it and people know that you're across the board, you're going to have support.
Well, let me give you one example that has been brooded about by many people. Yeah. I think Mr. Buckley among them, though I don't want to, God knows he doesn't need words put in his mouth. Social Security payments have gone up far faster than the rate of inflation. It may sound cruel to say it this way, but that constituency, which is a powerful electoral constituency, has received a great many transfer payments since the late 1960s. Would you, as president, be willing to say to senior citizens, you also have to bite the bullet in a time of inflation. I will not urge or sign any Social Security increase beyond the rate of inflation. Now, that's certainly
I think
specific.
That's fair. You know, on the other end of the spectrum, you have a lot of young people who are paying more in Social Security tax than they're ever going to pay in income tax.
That's right.
But they haven't shown up yet in Washington. When they ever show up, there's going to be some action on the Congress.
So what I'm asking is, would you be willing to say, I'll take the heat even with a senior citizen lobby and hold the line on Social Security increases?
I don't think that'd be taking heat. I would say yes. In the first place,
they wouldn't need more payments if you controlled inflation.
That's right.
Because existing payments
the last thing they want is the same purchasing power.
Right.
If you get the inflation down to 4% or below, then you don't have that problem. But it's not fair to those who pay taxes to give somebody more than the rate of inflation.
But the problem you have, as we've seen, is that no matter what you do to tell somebody they have to suffer, I mean, Jimmy Carter's trying to get federal employees to pay for their parking places now. And I gather it's something of a revolutionary issue in Washington.
It should pass, and we probably should pay for ours. That's not a big thing, but it's symbolic.
Right, Mr. Buckley, I wonder if I could ask you to comment on this notion that I guess I'm groping for. Is it your idea that given where we are today, a president, particularly one who espouses more or less your point of view, has to be willing to say, I intend to fundamentally alter the course of government, of how it functions, of what it spends, of how it spends it, and that is A, necessary, and or B, politically potent? Do you see what I'm groping for in these questions to Senator Dole?
Yeah, I think the president is the style setter of analysis and thought. Or however he decides to pitch the argument, that's how it gets transacted. It doesn't mean that he wins, it doesn't mean that he controls Congress, but it does mean that he can direct the attention of the public to an analysis on his terms. The failure of the last two or three presidents to do that is, I think, the signal failure of effective democracy.
But then, see, what's interesting about that, I thought you were about to make a different and far more accurate point, which is that Nixon spoke as a person who was determined to reverse the growth of federal spending and restore power to the states.
Unconvincingly. Because he presided over a growth of the bureaucracy and over the largest unbalanced budgets in American history other than in wartime.
I thought you were going to say that the climate of Nixon's rhetoric set the stage for this explosive growth of neoconservatism that we're experiencing now.
Well, rhetoric is meaningless if it is only rhetoric, and I think that's the point of Senator Dole.
That's the part that disturbs me as a candidate. You know, you get a lot of rhetoric, and somebody can stand up with a lot of bombast and bring people to their feet. When you walk away from the meeting, you wonder what's he done for me? What has she done for me? And I think as a Republican, we must address the issues. And if we can't address the issues, we don't belong in this race or any other race. And we get back to welfare reform.
Of course, everybody says that. That's trouble.
Everybody says that.
You got to figure out a way of saying that.
But I don't know of a single candidate who's for inflation. We're all for a balanced budget. We're all for less regulation. We're all for a strong defense.
But are you? And this is a question asked without any setup. I should tell you. I mean, you're a senator from Kansas.
Right.
If we inquired at your office, would we find a list of projects? The other guy's pork barrel is your desperately needed federal program that would have benefited Kansas or Kansas farmers that you have stood up and said, it'll benefit Kansas, all right, but it'll hurt the country, I'm against it. Could you give us a list of those kinds of...
I'll give you one very recent one. That's on the Amtrak cuts that affected a line in Kansas. You know, my staff already had the release prepared. We ought to go out and denounce the Secretary of Transportation. Well, how are you ever going to save any money if everybody wants... save it for Kansas or Massachusetts or wherever you may be. And I think that we have to do that. And I represent a lot of farmers. We can cut the agriculture budget. You know, there's nothing sacred, but we've made it sacred. We're cutting, even trying to cut special milk programs for children. That's hard to do, but we're out of money. And it seems to me that once the American people understand that it's across the board, then they'll listen. They may not like it, but if you follow through and you get the Congress to go along, they'll accept it. But we have to reform the welfare system, and that's what puzzles me with some of the liberals still in the Congress. I mean, they still insist more is better, and even more is better than that, and we're running out.
But in the same way that, for instance, that over the past 10 years, a lot of people who once considered themselves liberals have found it necessary to redefine. I don't just mean Proposition 13.
That's right. Ed Muskie is a good example.
Well,
He's an excellent chairman of the Budget Committee.
Joe Biden is a guy who came out of the 60s but speaks very differently than other senators.
Right.
What do you have to tell the Republicans in the same regard? In other words, Democrats are finding they have to speak certain unpleasant truths to Democrats. Food stamps, I take it, would be one example that you would feel the necessity of speaking in a way that Republicans
Well, not just hear. Food stamps. You know, when you look at any poll and you say Republicans, maybe 2 out of 10 Americans say I'm a Republican. Now, we can continue to just vote no until the last Republican's gone, or maybe if we vote no long enough, we'll be in the majority. I don't know how that works. It hadn't seen a payoff so far. But it's not our philosophy. It's the way it's been articulated. We're perceived as anti-people, a negative force in politics. That's not an accurate perception. But why is it Republicans always end up being against this and against that? So whether it's food stamps or programs for the handicap or the WIC program for women, infant, and children, which has gone way, way up from $40 million to almost $1 billion, whether it's catastrophic health care or whether it's a balanced constitutional amendment for a balanced budget, which I support. Let's just, you know, rearrange our priorities and then make the Congress require a little discipline of us so we're not voting for everything that comes down the track.
Well, Bill, you've followed the British elections very closely in which a very conservative conservative of, I would say, not an intense amount of personal charismatic appeal managed to win an election with an extremely tough-minded, blunt notion of saying this is what we are going to do, and of course given that system they're going out and doing it. Is it fair to say that is your prescription for Senator Dole and his fellow Republicans? To define the positive in terms of saying things of whether it's the market system or what
I think that Milton Friedman is correct when he remarks that for the first time in American history people suffer more from inflation than they do from unemployment for two reasons. Number one, the general level of people for whom the incremental dollar means a great deal has risen, i.e. the middle class is larger. And secondly, the pains of unemployment tend to be short-lived. 50% of the people in the poverty level have a car that's less than 2 years old, for instance, courtesy of Professor Martin Feldstein. Now, under the circumstances, I think that an understanding of inflation will meet with a response which will be historically different from the typical response. Would you agree?
I think so. And again, it's not enough, and I assume it's going to happen in any event on either side. Rhetoric may carry the day. You know, we may elect a president, and nobody ever knows what he's for or against as far as specifics are concerned. He may have a grand design. Carter had sort of a grand design. When he started to put it together, it wouldn't stand up. It kept falling apart because he made so many promises in 76 and he ran right into the budget with a big deficit. He promised it's a balanced budget. We have a $29 billion deficit this year. And it's tough. It's tough. I think Carter would like to do more socially. I don't always agree with him, but he's caught in the budget. And so Senator Kennedy and others say, well, that doesn't bother me. I'm the senator. I can advocate more spending. And I would have to suggest that the Republican who wins the nomination, it's not going to be easy in the 80s. The seeds are already sown. It's going to be tough, whether it's in foreign policy or domestic policy.
Well, just quickly, one last. Are we out of time now?
I'm afraid we're out of time. Thank you very much, Senator Dole. Thank you very much, Jeff. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
For a printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.